Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Millionaire Dentist Podcast, brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. On this podcast, we break down the world of dentistry finances and business practices to help you become the millionaire dentist you deserve to be. Please be advised, we do speak with an honest tongue and may not be safe for work.
Hello and welcome. This is Casey Hiers back at the Millionaire Dentist Podcast in studio with co-host Jarrod. I love the 70s, Bridgeman.
Casey, what's up? Yes, today I'm rocking it like I'm from the 70s. My wife got me some shirts from this website I like where it's all like 70s.
What's in the Brady Bunch? What's the dad's name?
Was it Peter?
No.
There's Peter, Greg.
And Bobby.
Bobby. Those are the kids.
Was it just Mr. Brady?
Mr. Brady.
Yeah, you look like a little Mr. Brady going on there.
All right, I'll take it.
Yeah. Little throwback.
And you look sharp in your jacket.
Thanks.
Nice. Yeah.
Thanks.
That's sexy, is what they say. Casey, usually you and I come on here and, we have a good time. We talk about a lot of things. One of the things I wanted to kind of touch upon, we have some listeners out there who maybe sometimes think that what we're talking about may not necessarily apply to them right now because they've already moved up a level. They're already pretty successful. More money, more problems. When you're successful, you're just trading problems. Now, that may be less stressful, but I kind of want to talk to you and your experience and your forethought on like having these conversations with dentists and owners.
There's different plateaus of success.
Yeah.
And there's different challenges. I was kind of joking beforehand. This would be a stressful challenge. Ugh, jet fuel price went up on my private jet. This is so stressful. Like that's stress.
Right.
But that's different stress than most people have.
Correct.
Oh, what luxury car do I drive today? Gosh darn it. I can't remember which one needs to be driven.
Yeah.
Well, that's stressful. If you don't drive your car or plug the battery in, you'll have problems.
Right. Those sound like rough problems to have. See, and that's from my perspective. From someone who's not at that tier, is like, wow, cool, good for you.
Yeah. I mean, from a personal perspective,
yeah.
Purdue Boilermaker fan. Finally, we go to the Final Four. Was I there? Did I cry? Yes. Not important. Here's what's important. When you get knocked out as a one seed by a 16 seed, you have a set of problems. You know, you stink, get better.
Right.
It's uncomfortable. You don't like those problems. Well, now you go to the Final Four. You have a new set of problems.
Yep.
How do you get the fan base there? Flights, hotels, tickets. There is so much stress this week from so many people I've talked to who, but yet it's good stress. You want the stress. You're excited.
Yep.
So that's
you're stressed. You're not even going.
Who says I'm not going?
Are you going?
Well, we'll see.
All right. But
my point is there's challenges regardless. When I travel, right. What do I hear? Oh, my staff and my team are so hard in insurance and there's just no way to, you know, be rich in dentistry. And so many people just want to stay in that place.
Right.
But inevitably, there's people in that room who are like, I collect 1-8 by myself. My staff's fine. And
right. They
have different challenges. Let's get into those today.
Right. So let me ask you. Let's say a practice has mostly moved on to fee for service, but is there such a thing as too many patients?
Oh, I've had those conversations.
Okay.
Now, here's what's funny. Most dentists who don't experience this problem haven't heard this problem because those that have it don't want to share it because they almost feel a little guilty.
Right.
But I talk to people, clients and other that, yeah, they're fee for service. They are producing and collecting a lot of dentistry. And they're booked out almost to eternity. That's a great, who doesn't want that problem?
Right.
I talked to some people, you know, with startups the other day and they're going to get there, but it's going to take time.
Let me ask you. So what are some inherent stresses that could come from being booked out too much, too far out for eternity?
Well, you know, the domino effect is what do you do? Most practice owners like to work 4 days a week. You know,
right.
Do you work 4.5? Do you work 5? Do you work 6? Do you have room to expand? Okay. Well, do I bring on an associate? Well, there's a whole new set of challenges,
right?
Can I not expand? Should I have a second look? There's a lot of zigging and zagging that person has. But then if they're at their study club talking about it, oh, you know, what was you?
Yeah.
And so it's a challenge that some of you out there might have. And then the question goes, well, what do you do about it? Most of these challenges, there's the right thing to do based on your personal numbers.
Right.
We're
not
going
to give you actual, like, here's what to do today because we don't know you and your practice.
Yeah.
So,
but those challenges are real. And again, being insurance isn't an issue. Patients aren't an issue. There are a lot of practice owners where those two aren't issues, but their challenges are different.
Are vastly different.
Absolutely.
Okay, so let's say you've recently moved more to fee for service. You're starting to bring in a lot more income, a lot more collections into your practice. What happens if your CPA has not prepped for this or has not really accounted for this situation? Like, oh, it's great, I'm making, you know, hand over fist here, but my CPA had not foreseen that.
Growth that is not accounted for,
right,
pun intended, by a CPA.
Yes.
Yeah. What do you do with that? Well, if your CPA is non-confrontational, they'll just create a shareholder loan and, you know, kick that can down the road.
Right.
But that is another challenge. Again, I've grown so much that now my tax situation needs to be looked at, or, you know, oh my gosh, too much growth, right?
Right. You're either going to have a shareholder loan or you're going to end up with like a large tax surprise.
Unfortunately, those two are wildly common in dentistry.
Right.
And so most people would think, oh my gosh, you grew your practice, you know, 30, 40%. That's amazing.
And that is amazing.
It absolutely is.
You should be very proud of that.
But like we said, you're now trading one set of challenges for a new set of challenges.
Right.
Price went up on my private jet fuel, right? Ha yep. ha. Like, you're not going to get any sympathy at your study club, yes, talking about all this growth. But we see that a lot, man. They're growing and then they just get crushed by a tax surprise. Or how do I handle this growth?
And it can feel very depressing or sad.
Lonely.
Who's like, I'm making all this extra money's coming in and I'm just watching it fly right back out.
Yeah. There's not people going to give you a ton of sympathy. And a lot of people we deal with, when I mentioned plateaus earlier, they have hit a plateau of success.
Right.
A plateau of success that most of their peers cannot relate to.
Right.
And they don't know what to do. Again, that's where, getting your house in order, or a firm like ours, gets you to that next level, gives you that roadmap and takes you there. But so many of these successful people, they've hit this plateau. It's yep. rare air. And they look around and go, crap, I don't know what to do, because most people haven't experienced this. So I can't call my buddy from dental right. school and get his opinion.
Yep.
Because I don't want him to know all my success.
Once you hit that certain, you know, upper percentage of the neighborhood, it makes me think of that TV show Arrested Development. When Lucille Bluth, the mom, was like, it's a banana, Michael. How much could it cost? $10? You know what I mean? Because like, she had no idea. She hasn't gone grocery shopping in 40 years.
The first three seasons of Arrested Development is so good. It's a $10,000 suit. Sorry.
God, I do love that show. Okay, so your practice has grown. You've got a high income coming in, but your practice has a wrong structure. And, you know, we've covered this before on previous podcasts with, you know, Steve Levy, our CPA and JD, but kind of do a brief description of what that is, Casey. How does a wrong structure, entity structure, can affect your high income?
Yeah, I've had these conversations where they're like, I don't know how to pay myself. I have all this money sitting around. I could take it, but if, you know, do I have the right entity structure? Do I have the right income structure? Is my W-2 and distribution set up that's right-sized for me? Am I reducing debt? Am I saving for retirement? They don't know what to do with the income. Yep. And if you take it the wrong way, again, there are negative tax implications that just can smoke you by the end of the year.
Because you're going to be getting, you know, potentially double taxed on things.
We have seen some situations that the practice owner had no idea that simply a better structure can help them save tens and tens and tens of thousands of dollars more for retirement,
right,
and reduce tax liability by 30, 40, 50,000 bucks.
That's crazy.
And they look up and go, you've got to be kidding me. Nobody has told me this.
And how many years have they been doing that potentially?
Ding, ding, ding. Right? That's exactly right.
So, okay, they've got the high income. Let's say they've got the structure fixed, their entity structure, but they're now that they look at their account balances and they're just flush with cash. They're sitting on a lot of money, and that sounds great. And obviously it's not a bad thing to have as money, but why is that a stressor, and why can that be an issue of having too much money in your account?
Yeah, it's a challenge people are embarrassed to mention.
Yeah. Again, because most people won't have sympathy for you.
No, you're not. And you don't hear many people with these issues, but your practice account balances are flush with cash, your personal cash flow and income, you feel like you have, you know, plenty of money, you can right. do what you want. And your personal bank accounts are high. And so you're looking around and you're not sure what should you do with it.
Right.
Right. And nobody's really giving you a roadmap. Should I zig? Should I zag?
Or if you had asked them, they might have just been a yes man and said, yeah, sure, just go ahead and do whatever you want.
We hear that so often.
Yeah.
You go to one of your, you go to one of your external team and you ask for some advice and they just sort of back up what you float as an idea, where in reality, again, people in this rare era of heavy success, they're looking for good advice. Tell me what I need to hear, not what I want to hear.
Yep.
What should I do with all this freaking money? Like, that's a challenge for some practice owners out there.
I mean, and they know, you know, we're all smart enough to realize that having it set in a potentially just like a savings account earning a minuscule percentage is not ideal.
Well, there's, you know, when I say zig and zag, I mean, there's a lot of different things you can do, but in totality, your team needs to have a very personal relationship with you where they understand, you know, retirement savings, debt reduction, cash flow at home, cash flow in the practice, reduced tax liability. That's just five factors that need to be looked at comprehensively and universally.
And if they're good and worth their salt, they'll also be able to tailor it to your interests as well. You know what? You like doing the X hobby. Let's find a way to make that work into what you can do.
Yeah. Versus a CPA or a personal financial planner that just has the same plan for their 200 clients. And it's more of a, just a cookie cutter rubber stamp approach.
Yeah. Which might be fine for the normal person out there.
The civilian out there. Yeah.
Yep. All right. Here I am, practice owner. I've got patients out the ass. I got cash coming out of my bum. Let's do every form of that word. I'm fee for service. You know, I've got my structure fixed. What's next? Do I want to keep this golden goose opportunity that I have, or should I look into maybe it's time for an associate, or maybe a second practice, a second location, or beyond that?
It's interesting you say that, right? You're crushing it. Human nature. It's like, okay, what's next?
Yeah.
And so you've mastered it, right? You've got this golden goose, as you said. There's a temptation to, well, I'm going to go bring on two associates. I'm going to add three locations. I'm simply going to multiply this thing, and it's just going to be that easy.
Yeah, I hope it's going to be that
easy. Hope's a terrible business strategy. but there are times where it could be appropriate for a growth strategy.
Right.
Again, it comes back to what's the practice owner want. Most say, if I can just keep my life simple and hit all of my goals and maximize my profitability, I'll take that. And sometimes sticking with the golden goose is the best way to go. But other times it might make sense. Again, your team should be showing you business model options,
right,
to add another location in a different geography. Now adult babysitting comes into play. I mean, now you're going to go another $1 or $2 million in debt.
Right.
These are things that you'll have a lot of cheerleaders at your side when you float these ideas. And so you've got to be very, very careful. It's a challenge.
Yep.
I've dominated this part. Do I try to make it a multiple? We've seen people that it has set them back 5 to 7 years.
Right.
And it in their personal lives really suffered because of it.
I can see that for sure. Cause I mean, it's hard to not bring stress home no matter how good you are at it.
But there's other people where, yes, it makes sense to add another location, to bring on an associate, to expand your practice.
Right.
But people jump into those three things typically way too quick. And then
it feels good. It feels like it's a check. It's a check mark you can make. It's like, I opened a second location. I was able to, and it's like real tangible.
I did it once. Why can't I do it again?
Yep.
And, you know, a lot of folks get about 60% down that path and they go, oh, this emotional decision that felt good and seemed logical. I'm now hemorrhaging cash. All those challenges that I had, I don't have anymore. And I, fingers crossed, I really hope this works. Again, you need to have a plan and a team where you're more certain.
Right. And is that worth, you know, potentially 7 or more years of your time of playing catch up?
Yeah. I mean, it can really set somebody back. But again, those challenges, you're probably not going to go to your dental community events and, hey, everybody, you know, do you already make $800,000 in dentistry and save $250,000 and you're on track for $20 million
and
your fee for service and your staff and team are great and your overhead's low and you want to do a second location, you'd probably get booed out of the place.
Right, because most likely they're still complaining about staff and insurance issues.
Yeah, and those are real challenges. We talk about those, but they are not the only challenge. And I'm getting to a place where I've got to take a deep breath because it's not here, but when I go to events, I just... Oh, my insurance and staff and where I live, and it's just impossible to be successful. And I'm getting to the point where I'm hearing people on the back end of their career becoming bitter, and all they do is complain and just say it's not possible.
Right.
And then I'll talk to somebody in that same room that's younger and go, I'm good on that stuff, man. Yep. Like, I don't want to do it with the $500,000 I got to sit in my practice account. And like, should I wipe out my debt in one fell swoop, or should I have balance to it? Like, that's the different challenges that we have.
Casey, you actually, speaking of, you know, going out and speaking, you just got back from Nashville.
Nash Vegas.
That's Nash Vegas. How'd that go? Did you have a good time out there?
Great venue, full house. They'd add a table. Again, educating the dental community on this topic is the primary purpose. Do we want to meet people to talk and have offline conversations? Absolutely.
For sure.
We can't help everybody in the room, but if we find one or two that we can, then we'll allow them to go through a vetting process. But no, it was fun. It's a good time. I got out of there, though. I'm getting too old to hit Broadway and go to Tootsie. What's that? Blanton's? What is that? Nice bourbon? Yeah, I plead the fifth.
That's right. Casey, coming up soon, too, we will be in Boulder and Denver, both of those in Colorado, by the way.
Had a summer internship in Denver once.
Did you?
Yeah, it's changed a little bit. They made something legal, and every Yahoo in a van decided to go live out there with no plan.
Yeah.
And now it's a challenge. And Boulder, who used to be Keep Boulder Weird,
yep.
They used to be like the crazy suburb. Now they're almost as normal as Denver is, the area. Great area. And a lot of good practice owners. We're packing that house, right?
It'll be great. Yeah. Honestly, go to fourquadrants.com/events and check it out. We have very, very, very few seats left for our tasting in Denver, and for brunch, just a handful of seats left for that one too. That one's going quick. So please get on there and register if you're interested in coming. You'll get to hear some great things, hear Casey speak, see all kinds of great things, taste some good things, eat some good things. After that, we'll be coming to areas like St. Louis. We'll be in Boston. I mean, we're really putting you through the ringer, Casey, and getting you out there.
We have a stable of good presenters.
That's right.
So,
that's right.
Yeah.
Casey, anything else you'd like to add before you go today?
Whatever plateau of success you're on, you don't have to stay there. If you're struggling, you can get out of that. If you're crushing it, you can get to the next level and retire 5 years sooner with millions more. Wherever you're at, get to that next level of success. Don't be complacent. Mediocrity should not be acceptable. Don't let the boogeyman and those excuses keep you where you're at.
And don't be afraid to reach out and talk to anybody you can. Anybody that's a professional in that area. If you're afraid of, you know, my CPA is not doing what they need to do, maybe start researching, looking into a new one. Give Four Quadrants a call. You know what I mean?
I'm going to get off my soapbox and go watch an episode of The Brady Bunch.
All right. Have a good one.
That's all the time we have today. Thank you to our guests for their insight and for sharing some really great information. And thank you to you, the listener, for tuning in. The Millionaire Dentist Podcast is brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. To see if they might be a good fit for you and your practice, go on over to fourquadrantsadvisory.com and see why year after year, they retain over 95% of their clients. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.